stomped his feet in place and he wouldn't move another inch. And he was like, ugh, can we go? It stinks.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Muddled Dice. I think this is actually be episode number 20, actually. I'm Daniel, we got Gary and Tyke with us tonight. We've also got a special guest, comic book writer, creator of Last Sons of America, Warlords of Appalachia, and the newly released Smoketown, Philip K. Johnson. How you doing tonight, man?
I'm awesome, thank you guys so much for having me on.
Oh, thank you for coming on, man, we really appreciate it.
It's a pleasure, really enjoy you guys' podcast.
Oh, thanks.
When I it's been cool to I don't get to game much anymore, and when I saw that you guys had done a podcast on Last of Us 2, I geeked out a little bit. Like Last of Us.
Oh, nice! Yeah.
By far my favorite game ever. I love that game so much, and I was super jazzed to see the sequels coming out. And then I just listened to everything you guys said about it. It was really fun.
Oh, cool.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah,
thanks, man. Yeah, that was the Last of Us one was me and Gary. If you just you're wondering, President Camacho.
Yeah, it was fun though. Man, I like that game is so good.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a big fan of the. I know you guys said you hadn't played all the way through it, but I played through it like 3 times in a row. I mean, when it was done,
it was a great story.
Oh, it is, my God, I know. Like, the voice acting, the story, and the cinematography, and the music is just a masterpiece. I really like the Arkham games, too. And after I was done with Last of Us, I was like, God, like, what am I going to play next? Like, what could hang with this? And I ended up going back to – I played Arkham City right after that.
Nice.
And after about a half an hour, I was just like, this is stupid.
You didn't like Arkham City?
No, I did. I loved it. It just like just nothing. It just speaks so highly of Last of Us. Like nothing
else.
Like it just seems so shallow compared to Last of Us. You know, like I mean, everything about it was so much better than anything else I'd played up to that point. I still love the Arkham games, but man, Last of Us is man.
Yeah,
I ran into that one. Just to what you're saying, a direct comparison between the two games. Me and my buddy were playing on Halo, and this is back in the day, but we were on a Halo kick, and we decided, I was like, hey, we used to play GoldenEye all the time, let's try that. And we went back to that, and I was like, wow, this is bad.
Right, though, that game was it, man, back when it was out.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that was like the gold standard. Yep.
Totally.
Yeah. Like, so are you a big Batman fan then, Phil?
I'm a Batman fan?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, nice. Nice. Cool. What do you think of this? Totally going off script right now, but have you had a chance to read the new, like, the Batman Rebirth stuff with Tom King?
Yeah, I have some of it. It's good, man.
Cool, yeah.
It's hard to follow Scott Snyder, man. I love that run.
That's true. It is. Yeah.
It's been really fun to see the All-Star Batman stuff now, too. Like, if I had to pick a Batman, like, it's hard to do that because, I mean, all the runs are so different. But I mean, in my head, I guess Batman speaks the way Frank Miller writes him.
Okay. Yeah.
But I really love everything Scott Snyder did on his run. And Tom King's has been cool, too, though. So I can't fault him. Him and James Tynan on Detective, they've both been doing great work.
Yep.
Mm. Yeah.
So I can't fault either one of those dudes. They're all doing what they want to do with them, you know, like they're all very clearly in their element and doing what they want. And it's cool to see how different everyone treats it.
Yeah. Can't argue with you there. Cool. All right. So you want to just dive into discussion about Warlords of Appalachia? Cool with that?
Yeah. Whatever you want.
Cool.
Before we get into that, what do you guys think about the Batman stuff? Between like Scott Snyder and Tom King and everyone, like, what do you guys think about those books?
I loved it. Scott Snyder, Court of Owls, I loved.
Yeah.
I loved that storyline.
Yeah.
And before Rebirth, though, I read Tom King's Sheriff of Babylon. Loved that.
Oh, yeah.
So like, when I found out he was writing the new Batman, I'm like, oh, yes. And you know, his story
that was an awesome surprise.
I Am Suicide, I Am Gotham. Man, those are good.
Oh, yeah.
Really good.
I really dug it. And actually, Tom King. Forgive me, I forget where you guys are out of. Where do you guys do this?
We're in Northern Virginia.
Virginia, okay, cool. It's not too far. So yeah, Tom King is, you know, a DC guy, as I'm sure you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm in Maryland, and he and I actually have signed. My home store is Third Eye Comics in Annapolis, and I've signed there. And Tom has also been in there a handful of times.
Oh, cool.
I met him there, and I was in the store once when my first book, Last Sons of America, was out.
Mm-hmm.
There was an employee at that store who, I mean, I don't really know her. I see her in the store all the time. She's like, "Man, your book is doing awesome." Like, really? And because it was already kind of, it already been off shelves like a little while. I was like, "Oh, wow, really?" It's like, "Yeah, it just keeps selling, man. It's awesome." I'm like, "Huh, dude, that's awesome. That's great to hear." And then she started to kind of doubt herself. She's like, "You're from Babylon, right?" I'm like, "No, man, that's not my book. That's Last Sons of America."
Oh, no.
Well, it's still real good, too. When she tried to cover it, I was like, That's awesome.
It's okay.
Moving on. But that's all right. No hard feelings. The Sheriff of Babylon deserves it. That is a really awesome book.
Yeah. All right. Well, I mean, as great as Tom King is, we're here to talk about your work. So, I'm sure you've heard this question many times, but where did the idea for Warlord of Appalachia come from? If you can talk to that.
Yeah, sure. Let's see. This is a couple of years ago, and I just reread the Joshua Dysart, the Unknown Soldier run that he had done at DC or Vertigo, whatever that was. I really liked that run, and I got a little hung up on the concept of the African warlord, and I was reading some stuff on like Joseph Kony and Idi Amin, and it's just crazy what those guys get away with over there. And at some point, I just started kind of imagining what it would take for something like that to work in the States. And so I just started sketching out ideas of what an occupied United States would look like, and who's the occupying force, and what would have to happen for something like that to happen here, you know?
Right.
I went to high school and undergrad in Kentucky, and I know that place pretty well. I just started thinking about what occupied Kentucky would look like, and my imagination kind of ran away with me. It was like, it would be pretty wild.
Yeah, it would.
I was done really well. I was going to say, with Caden Mercer, like, is that kind of like your alter ego? Like, the way he looks and stuff like that, did you kind of like put yourself as him? Because I know you have that father-son bond too in that character.
Well, I'd love to look like that dude, but no.
everything.
yeah. Yeah, you know, actually, there's Warlords is definitely a personal story I've ever told. And I mean, I didn't think I'd be able to say it after Last Sons, because Last Sons was a big deal to me, too. But Warlords is just so much of everything that's in my head right now. Yeah. Like, I'm a relatively new father, and I'd do anything for him and for my son. I mean,
yep.
And
I completely agree. Like, I have a 17-year-old, and then I have a 4 and a 2-year-old. So immediately,
oh wow,
yeah, it's a huge gap. So immediately, when I started reading the Warlords, yeah, I attached straight to Chess and Cade. I was like, man, he would do anything for his son. And then I was also born in Fort Knox, Kentucky. So I was like, oh man, that's like check right there. I was like, yeah,
that's awesome, man.
So. But yeah, like I see that too with the Last Sons of America. Like, again, it's, you know, brother, and I know, because I don't want to give away too much to the people that haven't read it yet. But I know there's that family bond again, and especially now, like the kids are kind of like used as currency type of deal. So, you know, like dealing with family and all this other stuff. So I just like the aspect of using family in your book so far. I think is pretty solid, dude.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, I mean, I try to write things I understand, and I mean, I definitely, like, you know, like you, I know what it's like to have a kid you do anything for and be very protective of him.
Yeah.
And, you know, we look back at times in history and think, like, you know, we'd like to think that we're the people that would have stood up to, you know, the Nazis or whoever.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I got you. Yeah.
And when you have the kid there and you just want to keep him safe, that just yep. supersedes anything else, you know? And I just have to ask myself the question, like, what would I have done? situation like that. And the whole story is definitely built around Cade and Chess for sure. And then the other story, Last Sons, is all built around the brothers. And that's another thing I do understand. Right. Like, my relationship with my own brother, it's not clear, as clear cut. It's not like I am one guy or the other, but I do know what it's like to have a brother who you're so close with. He's like a twin, but he's also kind of your opposite. And in a way, the two of you kind of complete a full person. Like, my brother is, I've got several brothers, but one brother, that the one that's more, my relationship that's more at the heart of Last Sons, he's actually a comic artist, and he's kind of the reason I got into comics in the first place. Because I mean, when I was a kid, I wanted to be a comic artist too when I was a kid, and I ended up going the other way and became a musician. And my younger brother was also a musician, and he ended up becoming an artist. He's an artist now. So we started doing this, we made a little story for our sister together as a graduation present, and it was really fun. So we both, it helped us both become more serious about it. So now I'm writing comics and he's drawing them, and it's a cool thing.
It's pretty dope.
No, please go ahead.
It's pretty dope how, like, also in The Warlords, I love how you combined your love. I mean, you had this awesome story that you want to tell. You got the family bond. And then at the end, you also have your song lyrics and stuff like that, too. So it's like you're combining all your different loves for all different kinds of mediums all at once. I think that's pretty slick, man. I have to commend you on that. Yeah.
I appreciate that. Yeah, there's a lot of meat in this book for sure. Bring back to another creator, James Tynan, hearing him talking about comics is just super fun. Talking to James Tynan about comics is just the best, because he just loves it so much. He talks about how his passion project is The Woods. Not to say he doesn't put himself in every book, but The Woods is his thing, where he just, you know, by his own admission, he said he just poured himself into this book, and this is that book is everything about him, you know, according to him. I think that's really cool. If I had one book like that, at least so far, in 2016, 2017, it would be a Warlords, partly, because I have this son that means so much to me. Not that that aspect is going to change, but it's like, it's just so at the front of my mind. And, my service in the army and the political craziness that's going on right now is a huge part of that book.
Yeah, it's great.
And I was trying to figure out I was very much world building when I first started this project to figure out, okay, what would have to go wrong for this to be plausible? And then 2016 happened, and I didn't have to do any work at all, hardly.
it's like you were a fortune teller, man. You just already knew.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, it's well, don't blame the shit on me, man.
If I could ask, like, what are some of like the shortcomings that come along with like creating stories like this? Like, I think I read somewhere on some of your interviews, the Comic Code Authority, the CCA, like. Are there still certain guidelines that you have to follow? Like, is there somebody or some company that's been like, no, you can't, I don't know, do this kind of story? Or is it always kind of just like, you know, you already have an idea, and no matter what, you can go ahead and, you know, push forward with that?
Oh, no, I think I know what you mean. Did you hear me say somewhere that I couldn't say certain things?
No, I didn't hear it. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Oh, no. No, not today. I mean, like, at some point in an interview or somewhere, I said that, I'm restricted, but not that I know of by the Comics Code Authority, anything like that. It's because I'm an active duty soldier, and there are certain things can't.
Yeah. I mean, somewhere I was reading, if there was a certain guideline that you can't have, certain racist stuff or something like that in your comic book, like
I see
kind of guidelines that you can't follow, like, you're like, oh man, I have an awesome idea for this certain kind of story, but maybe this CCA or something like that. I was just trying to ask to say, like, besides all the bells and whistles that come with like creating your story and bringing it to life, what are some of the, like, I don't know, hurdles or whatever that you have to jump through?
See what you mean.
Publish, but yeah.
Well, if we had done certain things. Let's see, an earlier version of the story had stronger language, and I had to tone it down a bit to avoid making it a mature title. Because we didn't feel like the subject, it danced the line enough that it wouldn't really have taken much. Actually, that might have only happened in the last sons. But to dance the line between, it wasn't such hardcore material that it had to be mature. And it would just take the slightest brush up to make it, you know, general audiences. So I just kind of went through it and basically used the same standard that you would to put something on network television.
Yeah.
So I didn't have any, like the thing with the, I guess this is not really a big spoiler, but there's something, there's like a sexual assault that's implied in the first issue.
Mm-hmm.
And
with the president. Yeah.
If that had been a blatant, like on screen, like rape, that would have been a mature only title, but it had never been that strong. The biggest hurdles really would be the fact that I'm active duty and I'm not permitted to openly talk smack about an elected official.
That's
why you will not see any actual names in this book, but I mean, everyone I think understands. And it's also the left wing, right wing stuff is not quite as clear cut in this as for example, like everyone associates states' rights, the idea of states' rights, with the Confederacy, or even modern day, you would say, like, you consider that a right wing stat, like, you know, the idea of getting big government out of the business of the working person, get big government out of our lives. And now it's in this book, it's different. Now there's a new administration that has just taken power. And if you pay attention to the details, as you guys clearly did, as I heard in that podcast, how to say this? sorry, I've kind of talked myself into a corner here.
Yeah, that's fine, man.
We can go.
But anyway, there's
options for.
Right wing and left wing, like there are different sides to it in this book. Like not everything is clearly, like this administration is clearly Trump, and this is clearly this other thing. Like there's a little bit of crossover to make it a little more relatable to everyone,
Exactly.
That was definitely one of the things, one of the things I definitely liked about the book was, like, it didn't fit neatly into, the left versus right paradigm. Like it wasn't, the good guys are all on the left and the guys on the right are all evil, or the philosophies of each side are kind of all, there's very much a lot of gray areas. It kind of feels like that's the way the world, kind of like the current American political landscape is kind of seems pretty muddy. So given that, like, do you think this story would have been as resonant like 30 or 20 years ago? Could you have written this story?
I mean, it's definitely a product of its time. I like to think it would still be an interesting, thought-provoking story back then, but it wouldn't mean as much as it means now, where these things are actually happening. Like the sexual assault thing in issue one, that I wrote that well before the Roger Ailes thing at Fox News. That was well before that showed up in the news. Now suddenly it's happening.
Okay.
And like it was. I mean, when it came out, it seemed like I just ripped it right from the newspaper because it came out like almost the same time. But I had written that months previous.
Wow.
The thing when the Trump administration brought down the immigration ban, the Muslim ban, that's right in the front of issue two.
Yeah.
that came out. That hit shelves in December. And it's everyone's or November, whenever that was. And he's like, what do you do if you see a religious extremist? And there's like a list of religions that are on this list that are also on the Crisis of Faith Act, so that I completely made up. But then suddenly it's happening. And it's the reason that Kentucky, like if there was never a point in the story where I listed the states that were in the secession. There was 13 of them, mm-hmm. and most of them were places that had high Muslim populations. Like mm-hmm. Michigan was on there, and New York was on there. It wasn't. It's not North versus South this time. It's a bunch of states seceded as a result of that immigration ban that happened in my story. And the big reason why Kentucky is on that list is because there's a religion called the Mountain Faith Church or the Waterborne. And mm-hmm. there was at some point in the recent past, there had been a shooting by one of those guys, by a member of the Waterborne. And so Waterborne became this hot button issue, and they kind of got themselves landed on that list of bad guys. And suddenly states' rights is on the other foot. So now instead of being a red state thing, now it's sort of this cross-cultural thing where anyone who has a religion that's being looked down upon is suddenly like out of my life. So there's with little things like that inside cover thing that you guys mentioned in the podcast, or to give little hints about how this whole thing came and went down. And I swear, man, like as soon as I wrote any of that stuff, it started like showing up in my newsfeed. Like it was just super creepy.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so that kind of leads me to another question. I don't know how far in advance or how long before the book comes out that you wrote the story, but like, did the results of the November election affect at all how you ended Warlords or the trajectory, or was that written long before that happened?
Let's see.
I rewrote the ending a little bit.
Okay.
This is a complete arc, but there's also, I have no intention of being done with this world, you know, like I definitely want to come back and write more.
Good to hear.
Please,
I never intended for that to be the end, you know? I mean, it's, I wanted this to be a complete story so that people could read it and, you know, feel like they've seen the end. But this world continues to go on, you know, and I want to revisit it. And whenever I do revisit it, I still intend for it to be a product of that time, like whenever it's written. Whenever the next arc is written, whether it be next year or in 10 years, it'll be a reflection of things that are happening then. So we'll see. We'll see how things go. let's see. You asked. Sorry, I think I made it straight off of your original question. What did you ask?
No, that's right. What did I ask? Oh, I just asked if nice. if you'd changed the way the story ended based on the November election.
It was about. And I was like, you know what? Give me just another couple of days. Because I did not expect for things to go that way. And I did rewrite basically the Cade's monologue in the end.
Okay.
Where he's like, this place ain't yours. You know, and, you know, when you come down here, you know, I'll just be reacting and blah, blah, blah. That was, I changed that last monologue, the thing that happened with between him and, Altridge and his little monologue to when he grabbed the mic and basically spoke directly to the president. And that was new.
Okay, cool. Can you talk about what it was before that, if you mind sharing? I don't know if you want to.
It wasn't that different. It was mostly the words I chose that I changed.
Okay.
I don't think I had not. Altridge didn't get killed, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
I think Cade blew Altridge away after the election. and then the speech was a little bit different. Yeah, okay. It was mostly just a change of word. Like it was more of a statement and less of a wrap up. I'm not sure if I can explain it very well. It's mostly just the events didn't change all that much. It was mostly just the language you use.
Gotcha. Mm. Okay, cool. Let's see.
Except for blowing that guy's head off. I guess that's
significant
change.
All right, so cool. So let's move on to kind of like just general stuff. Tyke, I know you had some kind of like questions about the creative process.
Yeah, if I could, like just ask
please.
I know like like with the Warlords and then also, like I said before, with The Last Sons, like you put a lot of you invest a lot of yourself into these stories. I was curious too, like how do you, on a typical day, how do you go through it? Do you randomly have these ideas, sketch it out? Because I know you said you illustrated just a little bit, and then you send off to the illustrator. Like, what is your normal process? Do you, I don't know, just go ahead and, while you're doing your tours on the band and stuff like that, you have like, oh, I want to jot down this idea, and you just, you know, go off from there? Just trying to get an idea of how you start developing stuff.
Well, it's different when you're trying to get your first one done. It's different then than it is now, for sure. Because before, you really have to prove yourself. And if you're trying to make a comic book specifically, as opposed to a novel or a screenplay or whatever, you have to have, you can't just show a script to an editor. They want to see the art. Now, so you have to find an artist to sign on with you. And, you know, that can be a long process or just an expensive one, depending on how you go about it, you know? So for you, you got to find somebody that's solid, that whose art is not only good but also really fits the story. That's such an important thing, at least to me. Like, there are certain artists that I love their work, but primarily on a specific book or on certain kinds of things, you know.
I could definitely get that, especially like, you know, you can't have, I can't say you can't, but I can see how like the illustrator that you got for Warlords fits so perfectly, and then the illustrator that you got for the Last Sons of America, that it fits so well with that story, with that, you know, Frank.
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, I totally agree, though. Like, Matthew's work, Matthew Dow Smith is the guy that did Last Sons, and he has this very photo reference style, which is funny because he didn't before. Like, that was his first book that he had done digitally, and I really liked his work. It was, he did that on the Cintiq, and that was the first one he's done that way. Before that, he was all traditional.
Nice.
And he had a very, very different style before that. Now, I still loved it. But he's using a lot more photo reference than he used to. Before, it was it's hard to describe. It's like there are aspects of Mignola in his old work. Like, it's a lot of like heavy inks, heavy shadows. A lot of implying the shapes with the straight lines everywhere. It was really cool. But then when I saw what he was starting to do when he was playing around with digital, like, he was doing the same kind of thing with the heavy inks and the angular edges, but with photo reference, and it was just cool as shit. It was almost like a John Paul Leon thing, but with that extra little edginess I really liked, and it just made everything look a little more harsh, and it was just great for that book.
So did it come he would send you a rough draft, or send you a storyboard or some sketches, and then, you know, fill out from there? Or was it kind of just like he had free reign to do whatever? Like, was there any kind of like review process or anything like that?
I there's a lot of input, like a lot of back and forth. But I do try to give him a lot of freedom, like, not just him, but any artist that I try not to micromanage anyone. But it's funny because I read a book back when I was educating myself on how this whole thing works. I read a great book called Panel One, I think, and it was had different scripts and styles of different creators. Neil Gaiman had a Miracle Man story in there, I think, and a couple others, and it was very different. One guy had done a story that he basically storyboarded the whole thing, and he did his own thumbnails and sent those thumbnails to an artist who would then flesh it all out. And at a convention, I asked a couple of artists, like, how do you feel about, you know, how much detail do you want from a writer? Do you want just super rough?
Oh, cool.
Or do you want a lot of detail, or do you want, like, you know, like storyboard stuff? And whenever I would say the word storyboard, without fail, they always just seemed horrified. Like, dude, don't ever do that.
Gotcha.
I mean, it just seemed like there was, you know, they just, no one, it's almost like you're just kind of talking down to them a little bit. Like, I just want you. I have the whole thing in my head, and all I need is your hand. So just draw a monkey, and don't put any of your ideas into it. So I learned very quickly that was not the way to go, which surprised me, because I mean, it seems they want more creative control, you know, and especially since, I mean, they do control the visuals, and you need to be able to trust them to do that. So Usually I'll have a script that I'll send that's pretty traditional. I mean, if you know what a comic script looks like, it's got like, you know, at the top of the page, it's like page one or whatever, and then panels, you know, anywhere from one to five, maybe six panels with a little description in each one, and then the dialogue indented, and just trying to make it easy to read. And often I will get a page back, and a couple of the panels will be combined into one, or sometimes they'll add one, or, you know, if, like if I've, if there's a shape in there that's, like if there's a shot that has to be vertical, that has to be like tall and narrow, because if it, say it's
I got you.
You know, a picture of a like like someone standing in front of you, seen from a low angle or whatever. Like they have to kind of manipulate around things in a way that I hadn't thought of. And so I, whenever that comes back, you know, it's almost always better than what I had, you know, what I had suggested.
Well, that's what I was leaning towards was just like the whole. I mean, the whole part. I think it was the second issue once of Warlords. Mm-hmm. Once the Sentry stuff got sent out to everybody, like the whole countdown, and before everything, like that's for me, because I illustrate a little bit, but like for me, I'm just like, oh my gosh, this whole pacing. I'm just really curious how you and the artist were going back and forth. Like, okay, it just all seemed to work really well. It just seemed for me as I'm reading the comic, as just, you know, the person reading it, it just fit really well. So I was just curious, like, were y'all going back and forth? Was it like, oh, yeah, we could do it like this. This may work better. Because I felt, I don't know, it's been a while since I've read a comic. And I was like, holy shit, it's counting down. Oh, no. Oh, shit, this is happening right now. So I was just, I was like, oh, no, they got the dog. They got the dog, too.
Yeah, the dog.
But,
it was very much like that. It was a lot of back and forth, a lot of, a lot of communication the whole time between me and the artist, but also with the editor. And I can't take finding the artist either. Jonas Scharf, my editor, Eric Harburn, found him online. He had just finished art school in Germany. That guy lives in Germany. And he's a young guy, just killing it. And I'd never seen his work, but he was asking me, Eric was asking me, so I'm just wondering, like, who are you thinking of for like your ideal fit for this? And, I don't think I even sent the email yet, but I was thinking like James Heron. You guys know James Heron's work? He's been doing Rumble lately with Image. He had done, he did a Conan thing that was great. He did some BPRD stuff.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to check him out, though, man. Heron is Harren. He's probably my favorite living comic artist. The guy is just killing it right now. I was thinking somebody kind of like James Heron, but also like maybe a Tom Coker type direction or somebody with a little, like not quite as stylized as James Heron does for this particular story. And he's like, hey, what do you think of this guy? I don't think I even showed him yet the guy I was thinking the names I was thinking. And I swear he just completely nailed it. Like, this is exactly the guy that we need for this. So, it was awesome. And he was, oh my God, I loved it. It's just great. So well done. We're going to see him again.
Some of the stuff that I pulled up is just like the depth and the colors and the it's got like a cartoony feel, but it's just a great blend right
the
there.
His Deviant account, dude. Yeah.
Oh man, that guy is so good. I was very impressed with the find, and he was Jonas was incredibly receptive to all feedback, and the editors were great too. Like I mean, the editors were very hands on with it, but not to a point where it was like in the way at all. So we all talked about it and figured out. I think at some point it was before it was actually, like as it is now, the countdown happens in like gutters almost, like in between the panels.
Yeah,
and it sort of evolved into that. Like initially, it was going to be like these captions that sort of break it up. Like the captions were going to like as the gutters, but it was going to look different than it ended up. And we kind of went around. I think we tried like three different things before we settled on what we ended up doing there. And even up to the last second, I was still like, I wasn't sure it was going to work. I was like, oh man, what if this doesn't play? You know, like what if people don't get that it's being spoken aloud as they're seeing this? Like I wasn't sure how it was going to work. But it did end up working. Like hands off to the editors and to Jonas because it did. I really liked how it turned out.
It definitely worked. That scene was excuse me, that scene worked for me so well. It was, you know, we said it in the podcast too, in the review, the sense of urgency with the alternating black and white worked so well to me.
Oh, thanks. God, everyone else on that team, man, was just virtuoso. I was really blessed with how I got to work with those people. They're all just, I mean, even then, like the design people and Boom, everyone just knocked it out of the park. I don't want to forget the question though. Like you were talking about workflow and everything. Let's see. On the road, yeah. Okay, so workflow. So now that I've got a book done, it's easier to do your next one, and you don't necessarily have to have an artist attached from day one. Like when you do your first book, you're like, you know, show me what you got, and you have to find the right artist for it and pitch it with the art attached, and like, you know, show them that you can make a book. You need to show the editor that you don't need them to make a comic for you. You know, you can do it yourself, and they need you.
Okay,
you know they're looking for people who already know how to do this, who have already put their own time and money into it and can do a book by themselves and make it look great. And then they'll hire you to do it for them. And that's what happened with between Last Sons and Warlords is they, you know, I pitched the idea of Warlords of Appalachia. I think that time I might've still been calling it American Warlord. And I was still very much just a, like an idea. But he really resonated with that one. And ironically, it was not the one I thought he was going to go for. I had like just a stack of pitches. I was just waiting to like rapid fire them at anyone, you know.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, please.
I was wondering how much you have to bring to the table. Like, say you were going to just pitch one idea. Like, how many completed pages do you need, or do you need to have like say a book that's ready to be published if someone went through and first edited it and made sure that everything was good to go.
And you like mean like on the first one that you pitch, or like once you're
first one that you pitch?
I would say at least 5 pages, sequential pages, like all of the same scene. I mean, the more the better. Let's see, for Last Sons, I think I showed them, we had a cover and I think 6 sequential pages, and then a couple of character designs in the back, and a one page synopsis, and then the first issue script.
I like that.
Yeah.
And they could see that I could do it. They could see that I could do a whole script. They saw where the whole story was going from the synopsis. They saw the character designs, and they see the full cover. Like they could, it's very easy for them to imagine the whole series, you know?
Yeah.
That's what you want. So that's how Last Sons came around. But then for Warlords, I had just met my editor for the first time in person, because everything happens just, you know, on email. And I met him for the first time at a con, and we're literally at the bar, and he's like, what else you got? And so I just gave him the idea for Warlords, and he liked it. So then after that, he asked me to send him a written pitch that he could sell to, you know, his bosses. I gave him like a 1.5 page pitch after that with a more complete idea, fleshed out like where it was going to go. And then I gave him a more developed one after that. And then we started looking for artists, and it all sort of worked out. And that's where I'm at now too, where now you give them a bunch of pitches. They're like, okay, what do you want to do next? And I give them a bunch of pitches, literally one paragraph a piece. And they were like, this one sounds really cool. I think this should be your next project. And then they's like, okay, flesh it out some more. So I'll bring it back a longer one. And when something gets greenlit, then we start doing scripts. Or I've gotten a couple of opportunities to do licensed stuff where somebody will say, hey, would you want to send me some pitches for, you know, XYZ? And so then again, you just do like a bunch of paragraph pitches and see what they go for, you know?
Right.
But as far as my workflow for doing a script, it's very different, where I just, do a lot of spitballing. I just start writing out all kinds of questions and answers to those questions in different directions they could go. I mean, almost like a flow chart, like where could this go? Where could this other thing go? And it just sort of very slowly takes form. And then you start to see which storylines and which characters are most fruitful and you start to see which ones, you know, grow the easiest, and until one of them sort of takes charge, and then you start making it more detailed after that. And I take all the time that I can, any time that I can, I'll just jot notes in my phone when I'm standing in line somewhere, or I'll, you know, or backstage before a gig, or, you know, wherever. And then when I get to my computer, I'll put it all down in the same place just so I can consolidate.
Well, if I could ask too, I'm still relatively new to like actually.
Hello?
Did we lose someone?
Looks like Tyke dropped out.
No, Tyke. Mid question.
No, you cannot ask the question, Tyke.
Okay. Intermission real quick. Let me see what happened to Tyke. Sorry about that.
Good for being relatively new, Tyke.
I think Tyke's on a phone, so he might have lost signal.
Hopefully the battery didn't die.
Oh, God.
Oh, man. Let's talk about you guys for a minute. Tell me about the Dangerous Sea.
Oh, gladly. Dangerous Sea is a Viking-themed board game. You're about exploration, battling, collecting ancient runestones. Hang on. I'm trying to type to Tyke and talk at the same time.
Oh, sorry.
No.
Well, it sounds cool. I looked it up before this. It sounds like a really cool idea.
Oh,
you guys are going to Kickstarter it?
Yeah. We tried once, and we just didn't have the audience, so we didn't hit our goal. But we're trying to build an audience, you know, now, and then put a little more work into it before we try the Kickstarter again.
Right. That's great, man. Well, I'll be looking for it for sure.
Cool. Thanks.
The board game thing is something I never had enough friends for that, I guess.
I get that. I'm in the same boat.
Yeah.
I grew up with a lot of books, but I have a lot of friends over. I didn't realize the extent of that scene, you know?
Like, oh, it's
there's some people that are like way deep into it, much more so even than the video games. Yeah. And I guess this is a whole subculture I didn't even know was out there until recently, but it's just really cool. Actually, my store, my comic store, Third Eye, now has a Third Eye game store as well. And just, it's really eye-opening to go through there and see, you know, kind of stuff that's on sale that I just had no idea of. So look forward to seeing Dangerous Sea on those shelves, man.
Yeah,
people
thanks,
are really into it. They're really dedicated to that craft. And I didn't really know that there was a scene until one of my buddies from college he was painting miniatures, and I was like, oh, what's that? And it's Shadows of Brimstone. And he was coming up with new techniques for painting them and kind of like painting them with an airbrush in a way that the lighting only came from one part on the character. Like he was kind of like misting from one angle and giving it like dramatic Frazetta lighting. And I was like, dude, this is, I was like, I have not seen anybody do this before. And bonding with him over that, he invited me over for like some of his game nights, and we got to see the different games that were out there, like the ones that are real big, like Pandemic and all that.
Yeah, man, that's awesome. Well, it's great what you're doing. Look forward to seeing more of it for sure. It's a cool idea. I like it.
Thanks.
Are you already producing the thing at all? Like, do you have any copies of the game, or are you waiting until the Kickstarter is out there?
Yeah, we've got some like some review copies that were, you know, they're way expensive to produce when you're doing them like one at a time. So the Kickstarter, sure. So we can do like a run of 1,000 or whatever, you know, instead of
right exactly
paying like what do we pay here? We pay like $100 per review copy, I think.
Yeah,
which is still really cheap. But
we had the first prototype had different size pieces than the current one does. Did that one cost anything different, or is it about the same?
No, that one was about $30 cheaper, I think.
Okay. Yeah, so the cost has gone up on them.
Yeah.
But it's exactly what it needs to be right now.
Yeah. Cool.
Let's see. Tyke is trying to reconnect. Sorry about this. I don't know what happened.
Oh man, so it is no worries. stuff are you guys reading anyway, comic wise?
Right now, let's see, what did we just get? Tyke and I just reviewed that God Country recently.
Oh, cool.
That's good. I'm liking that. And we went back and reviewed Rebels from Brian Wood because, you know, his sequel series is coming out this month, actually, I think.
Is that Andrea Moody on art?
Yep.
Actually, he and I have been talking online, too. We might be pitching something soon, I hope.
Oh, cool.
He's doing some nice work. Some good stuff.
Let's see. Tyke's trying to restart his phone.
No worries. Well, magic of editing. Hopefully we'll get us through.
Yep. Hey, there he is. You back?
Oh, my goodness gracious. I promise you I'm not drinking enough to, like, do that kind of mistake, man. I was in the middle, like, hearing what he had to say, and I'm like, man, I had a question I wanted to ask, and the thing just, like, dropped. It was like, bam! And I was like, oh, no, are you serious? I'm serious right now.
Magic of editing. It'll keep us afloat.
Yeah, yeah. I might leave most of that in. We'll see.
I was like, man, this bourbon's pretty tasty. I'm hearing this conversation. I was like, man, this is great. This is a good time to be an adult.
Yeah.
And then it just cut off. I was like, oh.
Do you remember what your question was?
I was trying to ask about, like, what other kind of, like, what is your next plan from here? Like, I see you got, you know, you already got the comic stuff down. You're awesome at storytelling. I'm still new to the whole comic verse stuff. So I'm learning about Ed Brubaker. I read, like, The Fade Out. I read, what's his newest one that he's got going? The Killer Be Killed. Okay. And then I learned that this cat also did a co-write on the Westworld, on the HBO thing. Now that we actually, you know, got you online here, I was wondering, like, you know, what do you have planned next? Like, you were doing the music stuff, or you're still doing the music stuff. You're doing the comic stuff as well. What you got next?
Well, I want to keep doing both of those things. this mic, and I'll tell you, there's a little bit of the hassle getting this mic to work for this thing. I have this old microphone that I had back in college that actually is pretty solid, but the cable is really old and didn't work on my computer. And to get a new one that worked, I had to get an interface, and I had to get a cable from Malaysia or whatever. I mean, not literally, but it seemed that way.
No, but yeah,
you never know.
So there's some recording stuff I want to do.
Okay.
On, like, solo stuff, like, just, you know, just like multi-track with using the same horn. But that's more like, I'm just hobby stuff. It's not my day job. Mostly I play with a concert band and a brass quintet. Yeah. It's really fun. I write a lot of music for them too. I'm not willing to give that up yet, you know. Comics either. Like, it takes a long time to get into comics, and now that I'm actually making books, I don't plan on going anywhere. I'm having a great time with it. I'm working with new artists. I love the small group creative aspect to it, like small group jazz, you know? I mean, changing out one person, like just the colorist or just the penciler, or just the letterer, even, like, everything is just, everyone needs each other so much, and you change one person, the whole product changes.
And then the whole,
I love that, you know? And so I'm not in a hurry to go anywhere soon. I'm just now starting to cut my teeth on the licensed projects. And that's also been really fun. It's a whole different muscle than the creator own thing. So it's been fun. I'm actually writing a pilot right now, just for my own amusement, my TV pilot. And it's been really fun, actually, too. It's very different. And I mean, there's definitely similarities with that in comics, like the visual aspect. I mean, there's the craft of writing a script is different, because when you're writing a comic script, you're basically writing a letter to, like, a couple of people. Where you're writing a screenplay or a TV pilot, it's very different. You're writing something that has to be very easily read by a ton of people,
right?
And it's different. It's not like writing a novel or anything, but it's And actually, there's one story I'm dying to tell that probably would be best as a novel. Like, I was thinking of pitching it as a comic, but I think it's more, there's so much stuff happening in people's heads, and it's not as visual a story as some of the other ones that I've thought of. So at some point, I need to get off my ass and write this book. So, yeah, quite a bit. I mean,
a lot of shit you got going on, man.
there's a comic on my site called The Lost Boys of the U-Boat Bremen. I don't know if you guys have seen that or not, but man, if you haven't seen it, the artist on that is a maniac. He's so good. His name is Steve Beach, and he's like an old world illustrator, you know, like something you'd see in books like Howard Pyle, Robin Hood type stuff.
Oh, that's cool, yeah.
I mean, sort of. Like, yeah. It's sort of in that vein, but also sort of in the vein of the old EC Comics guys, like Wally Wood and Bernie Wrightson. Like, he's just tons of ink spatter and cross-hatching and just really great old sensibilities. Love his work. And it's a horror story set on a U-boat in World War II. And it's I'm very proud of it, and I would like to do a multimedia, almost like a concert with that story, where the pages of the comic would go onto a projector, while musicians play the musical score to it, and it's narrated rather than seeing the lettering. It would be narrated by a musician, and have like a little brass group playing the musical score to it. There's already some music to it. There's not enough for the performance, but there's basically an overture and one other movement that I've written already.
Well, that'd be really cool. I never thought of that. Doing something like that. That'd be really cool.
I would love to do that. Yeah, that would be a really fun way. Kind of like Warlords, where I have the sheet music and there's that trailer. We made a trailer for the first issue where a friend of mine recorded that first song in the back of that first issue. I want to find a way to marry music with the comics that we're making. So that, I think I really want to do that with Bremen. That would be a really fun project.
Cool. So I don't know how much you can talk about this, but can you talk about what license projects you might be working on, or what that future novel might be about?
God, I'd love to. I mean,
I understand.
The
novel, had to ask though.
I can talk very vaguely about the novel because it doesn't exist yet, and it's online, so I can do what I want, I guess. The licensed books I can't talk about yet, sadly, but hopefully soon there'll be something coming out. There's three for sure that are coming out within this next year, I think.
Cool.
And man, I'm so stoked to get those out there. But for now, let's see, the novel. Yeah, it's another thing about a parent, you know. It's it deals with about a guy who been doing anything for his kid, but this guy's not as lucky as Cade, and he loses her, or he thinks he does, and then he finds out later on that he has another shot at your back, but not for free. There are supernatural elements to it. A lot of it takes place in Charleston, South Carolina, and there's Charleston's a beautiful, amazing city, but it's also a lot of darkness in its past.
Right,
and there's some supernatural elements of the story that draw on, on Charleston's dark history, and explore some ideas of how that kind of power could be used in, in supernatural elements.
Ah, that sounds really interesting.
Yeah, it's really, really fun. It's dark as all hell, but it's really fun. It would be something that I would love to almost like my own version of what Constantine might look like,
Okay. Cool.
So are you going to be hitting up, I know you was talking about earlier about different conventions and stuff like that. Are you going to be hitting up Awesome Con this year? Or?
I hope so. It's, man, they put it the same weekend as Heroes Con too.
Oh no.
Oh, did they now? Oh.
Yeah, it's the same weekend. It's June 16th through the 18th, I think. And it's that same weekend that I don't know what I'm going to do, man. I love Heroes Con. I really do. But Awesome Con's getting better every year, too. It's super close.
I think Stan Lee.
Are you guys going to be at Awesome Con?
I'm going to be there. But, like, I want to – I've been another good friend of mine. He cosplays stuff like that. He was telling me about Heroes Con. And I didn't know they were at the same time because I was like, oh, man, I'd love to hit up both of them. But the past – I took my oldest the past 2 years. Took my wife the first year. And I learned my lesson with that one. Like, she can only tolerate so much, bless her heart. So after that, I mean, like, I want to say the past 3 years, yeah, definitely been going and having a blast. Man, everybody's so friendly. Everybody's – I mean, you could just go up to any table and just ask an artist, like, you know, just shooting the shit, just talking. And they'll just, you know, they won't shove you off or anything. It's always been a positive experience that I've had going there, dude.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Awesome Con's great. Heroes Con's great. I really seriously don't know what I'm going to do. It's only like 3 months away, so I guess I better figure it out. But I'm going to have to. I mean, if you guys are going to Awesome Con, that's definitely a point in Awesome Con's favor. But we'll have to kind of see who's going to what.
Yeah, appreciate that. Yeah, we've looked at other cons. It's like we're real small budget now, and you know when you're looking, and it's like $600 for a 10-foot for a 10-foot table. Puts a little damper in your plans.
Yeah, I actually haven't tabled yet on anything. I'm just not at the point where I have enough stuff to sell. I'll start thinking about it. I think I'm going to go up to Albany Con later this year.
Oh, cool.
Nice. Friends up there. Ron Mars is a friend. He's always talking up Albany Con. So I'm going to get up there this year and do my first table, I think.
Nice. Awesome, man.
Nice, man. Yay. Good luck with that for sure.
Thanks. Thank you. Appreciate that. Yeah, well, guys, seriously, let me know if you're at Awesome Con. I'd love to get together if that's possible.
Oh, will do. Definitely.
Oh, trust me. Before we sign off, you said you played Last of Us. That tells me you got a PlayStation account. So trust me, I'm going to ask for that, for that game attack.
Yeah, it's Mingus. It's Mingus. Mingus as in Charles Mingus, the musician.
Nice.
And then A-H-U-M. It's actually the name of a Mingus album.
A-H-U-M?
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, man. Find me.
I will. If you get something, it's from Hadouken. It's going to be just like in the podcast.
Like your name here.
Yeah. But you can just awesome, call me Tyke. Yeah, for sure. Oh, dude. Man, I tell you, I love just playing and drinking, dude. I'll just don't, like with the Battlefield and stuff. Don't depend on me to have your back.
Yeah, I don't do a lot of multiplayer. You whip my ass and whatever we do. I promise you. I just barely broke open Injustice like 2 weeks ago.
Oh, okay. I
got a stack of. I go to GameStop just to lust on everything and. I'll just buy like whatever's down to like 10 or 15 bucks. I'm like, oh, it's about to sell out. I better get one. And then I haven't played Rage yet. I've only played like two hours of Dishonored. I'm like, I'm years behind.
Oh, man. Yeah. Gotcha. Okay. Gotcha. You're a busy man. You're a busy man too. So that's understood.
Well, I'm trying to catch up. But anyway. Oh, you asked me what else I've got coming up. I should really talk about a thing I got coming out now. Smoketown number one just came out.
Nice.
And, I'm really proud of that book, man. Like the line artist and the colorist are both musicians, friend of mine, who I've worked with, who just happen to be artists too. And the book looks great. Like you'd never know that they have this whole other thing. Scott Van Domlin, the penciler, I met him. We were both playing together in the Glenn Miller Orchestra like 12 years ago. I mean, I wasn't even reading comics back then. I mean, like I had read them as a kid, and then when I went off to music, to do music, I basically gave up comics for years. And I mean, I wasn't even thinking about it then. And Scott, I'm sure, was the same boat. And he's this killer tenor sax player. And now Dustin, the colorist, Dustin Mollick, the guy who did the colors for Smoketown, is playing. He plays in the Jazz Ambassadors at the same unit as me. And he's just a smoking Barry sax player. And at some point I found out he was doing his own webcomics and we all just ended up coming together and making this book. And I'm super proud of it. So I want to give those guys, both those guys a plug because they're just doing awesome work. And I'm very proud of it. It's kind of a sort of an anthology book. Like, I don't know, like people, we've been comparing it to like Stray Bullets. If you guys know that book.
Yeah.
For the wider public, Pulp Fiction, where it's a bunch of interconnected short stories. Like each chapter is its own thing, but they also interconnect to give a more complete story. And that's what this is for sure. It comes out bi-monthly from Scout Comics. And yeah, it's coming out now. It just came out a couple days ago.
Oh yeah, awesome. I read the first issue. Yeah, for sure.
So I got to ask, I think I got this right, but I'm not sure. Is it the first issue of Smoketown, is that a reprint of Killing Marcus?
Yes. Originally, it was just supposed to be a thing on my site, just for our own amusement. I mean, uh-huh. We just made it because we could make it. And Jim Pruitt, you guys know who the Pruitt brothers are? I'm not sure. Like they've been around the industry a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were with Caliber Comics and part of Image a long time ago. And they've been around on the scene. Actually, Jim's twin brother, Joe Pruitt, is one of the high ups in Aftershock Comics right now.
Okay.
Jim just became the publisher of Scout Comics, which is a very young up and comer. And just met Jim at Heroes Con, I think, last year. And he was just kind of checking out my stuff, and he saw that I had put this new comic up just sort of for grins. And he was like, "Hey, I really like this. We should print it." And so he's like, "We got to figure out a way to make this into a series, though." I'm like, "Oh, okay." Well, it was only intended to be a one shot, but then I sort of revisited the story, figure out how to make a larger story out of it, and actually, I mean, because I had figured out more of the backstory that led into the events of Killing Marcus, and I sort of expanded on it and figured out a way to make something bigger out of it. And now it's this anthology that we're really proud of. Number two is almost done. It looks really great. And three is getting written right now, and I'm just super proud of it. So hope you guys dig it.
Yeah, I think, I read Killing Marcus, and that was great. So I'm looking forward to reading more in that kind of world.
Yeah, thank you. The next one is about Marcus himself.
Okay, cool.
The first one is from Jen's perspective, his wife, and the second one is from Marcus's perspective. If there was a theme to the whole thing, it would be that everyone is the hero of their own story. Like, no one is the bad guy, no one thinks they are anyway.
Right. Okay.
Right. So you see more of what made Marcus who he was, and you keep taking a step back in the story and seeing more from the perspectives of the other characters, and see everyone's perspective on it, and who's really the hero, and what's, it's just really fun, man. I'm having a great time with it.